Well, good evening and welcome to our service tonight. Good to have you with us as we meet together once again to worship God. We'll be turning to Romans chapter 3 later on as we continue our series in Paul's letter to the Romans, and we look at this challenging section from verse 9 through to 20 later on this evening. This week is, of course, Holiday Bible Club week, so a big thank you to all of those who are involved in whatever way over the course of the next 5 evenings. The Holiday Bible Club will be meeting at 6 o'clock through to 7:30 each evening. That means that there's no regular prayer meeting on Wednesday evening, though there will be a brief time of prayer each evening after the Holiday Bible Club has finished. So do be remembering that in prayer, and do be coming along to help out if you're able to do so and have signed up for that in these next 5 evenings. Then I think the only other thing to mention is looking ahead to next Sunday for the services at the usual times of 11:30. We're going to be in John's Gospel as I take that service. And then 6 o'clock for the evening service, at which Ethan is due to be preaching, and he'll be in the book of Exodus once again. As I mentioned this morning as well, we have some of these free books to give away, Side by Side, all about living together in the fellowship of the church alongside one another. They're absolutely free, so if you'd like a book, just let me know, and there's one for you. I've left one copy on the desk as you head out, and so you can have a look at it. It's just a very short, practical, easy read, but highly recommended. And so if you'd like a copy of that, just let me know, and we'll get that to you. Well, as our call to worship this evening, I'd like to read just a short section from Mark chapter 2. We read these words. As Jesus reclined at table in Levi's house, many tax collectors and sinners were reclining with Jesus and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. And the scribes of the Pharisees, when they saw that he was eating with sinners and tax collectors, said to his disciples, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" When Jesus heard it, he said to them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners." And that's good news for us, because as we'll see this evening, as we turn to Romans chapter 3, we are all sinners. There is none who is righteous, and therefore we all need Jesus, as Paul has been telling us in these opening chapters of his letter to the Romans. And one of the places to which Paul will point in Romans chapter 3 to make his point is Psalm 14. He quotes from the opening verses of this psalm to impress upon us the fact that there is none who is righteous, all are sinful. And so we're going to sing this psalm now as our opening item of praise, Psalm 14. We'll sing the whole psalm. The fool speaks in his heart. "There is no God," he says. "They are corrupt. Their deeds are vile. None walk in godly ways." Psalm 14. We'll stand and sing together.
broken down, they are with dread. For God is with the just. You evil doers shape the poor, but in the Lord they trust. May help come, Zion come. The Lord his captives bring, and then let Jacob's tribes rejoice. Let Israel gladly sing.
Well, let's come to God now in prayer. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this day. And we thank you that once again this evening we can gather together as your people to worship you. And because you have called us out of the world and you've called us together as your people. And we praise you for who you are. You are the God who is enthroned in the heavens. You are the God who is eternal, infinite, and unchanging. You are the God who is holy, holy, holy. You are righteous in every way. And you are all wise, and you are all powerful, and you are all good. We praise you, the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We praise you as well for your glorious works. We thank you for the beautiful day that it is today, and for the splendor of your creation, which proclaims your glory. You are the God who created all things, and for all that you have made, we worship you. And yet we praise you even more than this for your grace towards us in Christ, that you sent him into the world to be our Savior. And as those words of Jesus in Mark chapter 2 have reminded us already, Jesus came not to call the righteous, but sinners. And so as we come to you tonight, we confess that we are sinful people, and yet we look to Jesus for our forgiveness and our acceptance with you. You are the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. You are the maker of all things, and you are the judge of all people. And we acknowledge before you our many sins which we have committed in our thoughts and in our words and in our actions. We have provoked justly your wrath against us. And we repent of our sin. And we are truly sorry for our wrongdoings. We're grieved when we remember them. And we pray that you would have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past. Because of all that Jesus has done for us in going to the cross in our place. And grant that from now on, we would serve and we would please you in newness of life to the honor and the glory of your name. And so we pray that tonight we would know your blessing as we gather to worship you. Draw near to us as we draw near to you. And we pray that you would make your face to shine upon us and be gracious to us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. As we consider the universal sinfulness of man, let's hear some words of encouragement now from Psalm 130. I'll read a selection of verses from that psalm, where the psalmist writes, "If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption, and he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities." So let's sing together now once again as we're going to turn to hymn number 454. "It is not by works of righteousness which our own hands have done, but we are saved by sovereign grace Abounding Through the Sun, hymn number 454. We'll stand and sing. Let's turn in our Bibles, please, to Romans chapter 3 as we continue with this chapter. And we're going to begin from verse 9 this evening, this next little section of the letter. As Paul continues to speak to his fellow Jews in this section, we read as follows in chapter 3 and verse 9 and following. Paul says, "What then? Are we Jews any better off? No, not at all. For we have already charged that all, both Jews and Greeks, are under sin. As it is written, none is righteous, no, not one. No one understands, no one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one. Their throat is an open grave. They use their tongues to deceive. The venom of asps is under their lips. Their mouth is full of curses and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. In their paths are ruin and misery, and the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be stopped, and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in his sight, since through the law comes knowledge of sin." Now we finish our reading of God's word at verse 20 of Romans chapter 3. And we thank God for this, his word to us, and we pray for his blessing as we hear his word tonight. So we're going to come to God in prayer now. Let's all pray together. Father, we do thank you for your word. And as tonight we listen to these words of Romans chapter 3 a little later on, we confess even now that we are sinful people by nature. And we know that even today we have committed sins in thought and word and deed. We've fallen short of your perfect standards, and we deserve your condemnation. And we know that there is nothing that we can do through our own works in order to earn your acceptance. But we thank you for your Son, Jesus, and for what he has done for our salvation. We thank you that he has done what we could never have done for ourselves. We thank you for his perfect life of obedience, fulfilling your law to the letter, doing so in the power of the Holy Spirit. We thank you that he gave himself at the cross for our salvation, dying in our place to free us from all condemnation, and then rising again so that in him we can be declared right in your sight. And Father, even as we rejoice in all that Jesus has done for us, we long for others also to come to know him and be found in him. And to that end, we pray for our efforts in the coming days at Holy Bible Club. We thank you for the reminder this morning that Jesus provides for his people by divine power, and yet so often he is pleased to work through human means, through human agents. And we pray that you would use us, therefore, in your purposes this week, that we would know your strength and help and blessing, and that we would see you at work through us in the hearts of many young people. We pray that as your word is taught and as conversations are had, that you'll be working by your Spirit in the hearts of these children and young people. And we pray that through this ministry, and as well as that through other avenues of ministry, that you would add to the church those who are being saved. And Father, we pray as well for those going through times of difficulty. And again, we thank you for your word this morning, reminding us that Jesus sees our needs and he is filled with compassion for us in those needs. But also at times, he tests our faith. Father, we again pray for those whose faith is being tested at this current time, that you would strengthen them, that you would comfort them, that you would draw near to them. We do pray for those not able to be here. We think of Maud, once again unable to be with us on a Sunday as she still continues to recover. We ask that she would know your blessing. We pray for Ethan and family in their circumstances as Ethan preaches this evening at Cross Collier Street. We ask that they would know your blessing. And we lift before you the concerns regarding their visa. We pray that as time is now short, that the visa would come through quickly. That, Lord, you would pave the way for Ethan to begin his ministry fully in Cross Collier Street. And Father, we pray for your blessing this evening upon ourselves. We look to you that we might receive mercy and find grace to help in times of need. We ask that you bless us as we hear your words this evening and build us up in Christ. Humble us because we face the reality of our sin, but encourages us as we look away from ourselves to our Saviour, in whose precious name we pray these things. Amen. Well, we're going to sing together now hymn number 493. Not what my hands have done can save my guilty soul, and nothing that this flesh has borne can make my spirit whole. Hymn 493, and again we'll stand to sing together. Spirit whole. Be seated. Let's pray together. We confess, as we've just sung, not what my hands have done can save my guilty soul. Your work alone, O Christ, can ease this weight of sin. And your grace alone, O God, to me can pardon speak. Father, we pray you bless us as we come to your word now. Show us your grace to us in Christ. Show us our need for that grace, that we might praise the God of grace and trust in your truth and might in Christ for salvation, as he is offered to us in the gospel. Bless us now, we pray, as we ask it all in your Son's glorious name. Amen. So please do have your Bible open there. Romans chapter 3, and this evening we're in verses 9 through to 20. And if you've been here over recent weeks, you'll know that we've been working our way through this difficult section of Paul's letter to the Romans, where the point that Paul is making is very simply this: the gospel is for everyone, because everyone needs the gospel. And bit by bit, Paul has been building that argument, as we've seen. In the closing verses of chapter 1, Paul showed us that morally depraved people need the gospel. Then in the opening verses of chapter 2, he showed us that morally respectable people also need the gospel. And then he showed us that Gentile people who don't have God's law need the gospel. And since then, he's been showing us that Jewish people who do have God's law need the gospel. And tonight we come to the final part of this section of the letter, where Paul sums up the argument that he's been building ever since chapter 1, verse 18. And again, the point, very simply, is this. Everyone needs the gospel. So as we come to this passage, we're going to see how Paul drives that point home in this concluding section of this part of the letter. And first of all, we're going to see this. Every person is under sin. Every person is under sin. A little while ago, I was chatting to a friend of mine who's not a Christian, and we were talking about various different things, chewing the fat, as we spoke about things that have happened recently, some of the things in the news, but also things going on in this person's own life. And towards the end of that conversation, my friend looked at me and he said, "Andy, the thing is, some people are good, but some people are bad. Some people are good, but some people are bad." And I would guess that is probably what most people believe, isn't it? Some people are good, but some people are bad. Some people do good things like caring for the environment, being kind to their neighbours and so forth. Whilst other people do bad things like causing riots. And maybe most people are in the good category, but some people are bad. And yet that's not the way that the Bible describes the human race. And that's not the way that Paul here in Romans chapter 3 describes the human race. So just look at what he says there in verse 9 as he kicks off this part of the letter. At this point, he's still speaking to his fellow Jews primarily. And he says, "What then? Are we Jews any better off? No, not at all. For we have already charged that all, both Jews and Greeks, are under sin." Now with that phrase, under sin, Paul paints a picture. And he's describing sin as being like a tyrant, a ruler, under whose reign we all live, under sin. And so we're enslaved to this tyrant's demands. We're unable to rescue ourselves from it. By nature, we're all under sin's dominion, living under its rule, subject to its condemnation. Later on in the letter, Paul is going to use that same imagery, especially in chapter 6, to describe what it means to be in the grip of sin. And he says, "Do you not know that if you present yourselves to anyone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness." Remember the words of Jesus in John's Gospel, that he says that those who sin are a slave to sin, under sin. And what Paul is saying here is that all of us, whether we're Jews or Gentiles, whether we're fairly respectable people or whether we're downright awful people, are under sin by nature. And yet Paul doesn't want us to just take his word for it. And so what he does in the next few verses is that he quotes from the Old Testament no fewer than 6 times. Now this is a favorite Jewish teaching method. It even has a name. It's called Charaz. And literally what that word means is a string of pearls. So imagine someone making a necklace. And one by one, they add more and more pearls onto the string. And you might think of this list of 6 Old Testament quotations as being like a necklace with 6 pearls on it. Only this is not a pretty necklace. Because the point of it is to show the sinfulness of the human race. And Paul mainly quotes from the book of Psalms here, although he does have one reference from Isaiah as well. But for now, it's worth just looking at the first of those 6 quotations, because the first one is the headline that stands over the other 5, as we shall see. And he takes us, first of all, to Psalm 14. That psalm we sang at the start of our service this evening. And that psalm describes what God sees as he looks down from heaven at the children of man on the earth. Verse 2 of that psalm has God looking down from heaven at the children of man. And what does God make of the human race as he looks down from heaven? Is his view of things that some people are good but some people are bad? Well, far from it. This is what God sees as he looks at the earth. None is righteous. No, not one. No one understands. No one seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they've become worthless. No one does good. Not even one. This is God's assessment of the human race. This is what we're all like by nature. And that point is hammered home again and again and again in those words from Psalm 14. By nature, we're not good people. We're not righteous. We don't understand. We don't seek for God. Instead, we turn aside from him. We go our own way. Because by nature, we're living under sin. We're living under its rule and obeying its demands and facing its condemnation. And Paul's not just talking about the really bad people in the world here. No, he's talking about me, and he's talking about you, and he's talking about your friends and your family, your neighbors, your colleagues, and of course he's talking about himself as well. Every person is under sin. That's the headline, that's the main pearl on the necklace, if you like. But then there are five more pearls on the necklace to look at. And these next five quotations develop that point further still. And if the point of the first quotation is that every person is under sin, the point of the next five quotations is this: every part of every person is under sin. Every part of every person is under sin. I wonder if you've ever had to go to the doctors for a full body checkup. Thankfully, that's not something that I've been subjected to myself. But in such a checkup, the doctor will poke and prod as he or she investigates the state of your whole body. And we can think of these next five Old Testament quotations as being a little bit like a full body checkup. So think of Paul being like a doctor giving us a full examination. It reminds me of Isaiah chapter 1. Isaiah uses that imagery of a doctor assessing a person's body and finding that every last bit of that person's body is sick. Remember those words from Isaiah 1? Isaiah says, "The whole head is sick, and the whole heart faint. From the sole of the foot even to the head, there is no soundness in it, but bruises and sores and raw wounds. They are not pressed out or bound up or softened with oil." And Paul is doing a very similar thing here. Because notice in these next five quotations from the Old Testament, each one of them refers to a part of the human body. And so it's like a full body checkup, a thorough examination of the whole person. And having established that every person is under sin, Paul is now saying, well, how serious is that condition? How far has this sin spread in each person? And so to start with, he says, open wide, let's have a look in your mouth. It's often what doctors do, isn't it? You go to the doctor and you say to the doctor, you're not feeling very well at the moment. And usually the first thing they see or they say for some reason is, open wide, let me have a look in your mouth. And that's usually where God starts as well when he's diagnosing the state of sin in a person's life. Look at their words, first of all, because there are few things that reveal a person's sinfulness than their words do. Because a person's words are like a window into their heart. As Jesus says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so what does God's word have to say about the state of people's mouths? That is, what does God have to say about the kind of words that people speak? Well, verses 13 and 14 give us three Old Testament references. They're from Psalms 5, 140, and 10, respectively. But they all refer in some way to the way that people use their mouths, the kind of words that come out of their mouths. So from verse 5, their throat is an open grave. They use their tongues to deceive. And then from Psalm 140, the venom of asps is under their lips. And then from Psalm 10, their mouth is full of curses and bitterness. And in a very similar way in the New Testament, James says, the tongue is a fire, a world of unrighteousness. The tongue is set among our members, staining the whole body, setting on fire the entire course of life, and set on fire by hell. For every kind of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature, can be tamed and has been tamed by mankind. But no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil, full of deadly poison. Probably more than anything else about us, it's our words that reveal how sinful we really are. Angry words, obscene words, untrue words, unkind words. And that's why Jesus says, I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give account for every careless word they speak. But Paul doesn't stop with the mouth. This full body checkup continues. Next, Paul says, take off your shoes. Let's have a look at your feet. And of course, again, he's not speaking about feet literally. He's speaking metaphorically. It's a picture of a person's way of life. How are they walking, so to speak? In what direction are they going? In what way do they live their life? What is their way of life? What do they chase after? What do they pursue? What do they follow? Well, this time the quotation's from Isaiah. It's from chapter 59 of the prophet Isaiah. And Paul shares these words. Their feet are swift to shed blood. In their paths are ruin and misery, and the way of peace they have not known. Paul is saying, with Isaiah to back him up, the way that people live their life, their way of life, is so often in the direction of disharmony with others and hostility towards others. And they pursue things in life that will only bring them ruin and only bring them misery in the end. And God would have people live peaceably with one another. And yet by nature, people do not live peaceably with one another. And so relationships end and marriages break down and friends fall out and families fall apart. And tribes attack one another and nations go to war against one another. Their way of life brings disharmony into the world in one way or another. And still this full body checkup continues. We've looked at the throat, the tongue, the lips, the mouth, and the feet. And now Paul is going to look at our eyes. And so from Psalm 36, Paul says this, there is no fear of God before their eyes. And of course, again, Paul is not talking about eyes literally. He's speaking figuratively. And by eyes, he's talking about their outlook on life, or we might say their worldview. And he says, by nature and under sin, there is no fear of God before their eyes. God has been airbrushed from their worldview. Their outlook on things excludes God in their way of thinking. The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom, but there's no fear of God in the hearts of these people by nature. And in whatever worldview they adopt, they push God and the fear of God conveniently to the side, in the margins at best. And their outlook is to approach life without reference to Him. There is no fear of God before their eyes. And Paul could, of course, continue with this full body checkup. He could explore the human mind with its futile and darkened thinking. He could speak about human hands and the sins they carry out, and so on and so on. But he's made his point. And his point is that it's not just the case that every person is under sin, but more than that, it's the case that every part of every person is under sin. Their mouth, their feet, their eyes, representing their words and their way of life and their worldview, all corrupted by sin's stain. And of course, it all flows from their heart, ultimately. And indeed, that final quotation that Paul shares is Psalm 36, verse 1. But if he'd gone from the start of the verse, this is what it says. Transgression speaks to the wicked deep in his heart. It's all from the heart, ultimately. As Jesus puts it, from within, from out of the heart of man, come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person. From that sinful heart come sinful words, a sinful way of life, and a sinful worldview. And the result is that every part of every person is under sin. And as you might know, this is what we often call the doctrine of total depravity. Maybe you've heard that term, but don't misunderstand it. It doesn't mean that people are as bad and as sinful as they could possibly be. Of course, that's not the case. And indeed, back in chapter 2, you remember Paul said that sometimes Gentiles who do not have the law by nature do what the law requires. And he pointed out that unbelievers are able to do good things, as we all know. No one is as bad as they could possibly be. And yet what we mean by total depravity is that sin has spread to every part of us. We've used this illustration before, but think of when you pour yourself a glass of diluting juice. You put the concentrate in, and then you add the water, and it all mixes together. And it's not that the drink is as strong as it could possibly be. And yet it is the case that the flavor of the concentrate, orange or blackcurrant or whatever it might be, that flavor spreads throughout the whole glass. And so you can taste that flavor in every last sip. And in a similar way, sin works like that within a human being. It gets everywhere, absolutely everywhere. And it begins in the heart, but from there it gets into your words, and it gets into your way of life, and it gets into your worldview. And the bitter taste and the corrupting stain of sin touches everything within us, even our best moments. Every part of every person is under sin. And then thirdly, we see this. God's law convicts you of your sin. God's law convicts you of your sin. Over the last week or so, following the riots in various cities throughout the UK, the news has since then been filled with reports of literally hundreds of these rioters who have been arrested and are now being brought into court one by one in order to be convicted of their crimes. And it's that imagery that Paul uses here in verses 19 and 20. In the imagery that Paul is using, we've gone from the doctor's surgery, where that full body examination takes place, now to the judge's courtroom, where the accusations are brought and the conviction takes place. And what is the means that brings about the conviction of sinners? It is the law of God. And when Paul speaks here about the law, he's not just speaking more narrowly about the commandments that God has given, No, he's speaking about all of the Old Testament, including those verses that he's quoted from in the Psalms and in Isaiah. God's law, broadly defined, the Old Testament, broadly defined, convicts people of their sin. Now, Paul anticipates an objection here from his Jewish fellow man. And he anticipates that they might say, well, yes, those verses that you've quoted certainly convict people of sin. This is God's law as it's presented in the Psalms and in Isaiah and so forth. But those verses are really speaking about God's enemies. Surely they apply to the Gentiles. And for sure, the law of God convicts them of their sin, but not us. And Paul anticipates that objection, and he says, now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law. And of course there, when he speaks about being under the law, what he's saying is that the law of God addresses the Jews firstly, and then by extension, the law of God addresses the Gentiles also. And therefore, the result of that is that every mouth may be stopped and the whole world may be held accountable to God. Paul knows we love to make excuses for ourselves, don't we? At the very first hint of guilt arising, our inner lawyer springs into action and starts to give reasons why we don't deserve to face God's condemnation for our sin. And one of the easiest ways to do that is to say that our sin wasn't really our fault. It was all as a result of our upbringing or our circumstances or other people who provoked us to it. And then we point at other people and we say, well, I might not be perfect, but other people are far worse than I am, and they deserve God's judgment, not me. And indeed, if we only compare ourselves to other people, we could come out of it looking pretty good, at least most of the time. But the problem is, the standard by which we will be judged is not other people. The standard is God's law, his perfect, righteous, holy, pure law, which is a reflection of the very perfect righteousness and holiness and purity of God himself. The law of God reflects the character of God in all of his beauty and perfection, all of his holiness. And therefore, when we come face to face with God's law, that's what silences all of our petty excuses for our sin. And so the whole world, Jew and Gentile, and me and you, the whole world is held accountable before God. Because as Paul says there at the end of verse 20, through the law comes knowledge of sin. And again, the imagery has changed. We've gone now from the courtroom to the classroom. God's law is like our teacher. God's law shows us what we're really like in our sin. Or you might compare God's law to a mirror in which you see what you're really like. And you know how it is when you get up in the morning and you wander into the bathroom and you look in the mirror. And if you're anything like me, it's not a pretty sight. The mirror is honest. The mirror is unforgiving. The mirror shows us what we're really like. You look in the mirror, and even if you didn't realize it before, now you know your hair is a mess, your face is dirty, there are bits in your teeth. And in a similar way, when we look into God's law, that's when we begin to see what we're really like. Through the law comes knowledge of sin. And we begin to realize we're more sinful than we ever thought we were beforehand. And so God's law stops our excuses, holds us accountable, reveals the knowledge of sin, and by so doing convicts you of your sin. And yet there's one more thing that Paul has to say in this passage, and we just consider it very briefly. And that is, God's law cannot save you from your sin. God's law convicts you of your sin, but God's law cannot save you from your sin. So let's return to the analogy of the bathroom mirror. You're standing there in front of the mirror, which has revealed to you that your hair is an absolute state. What are you going to do about it? Well, here's what you don't do. You don't take the mirror off the wall and try and comb your hair with it. Of course not. You need to know what the mirror is for and what the mirror is not for. Because the mirror shows you the state of your hair, but the mirror doesn't fix the state of your hair. And in a similar way, God's law shows you the problem of your sin, but God's law doesn't fix the problem of your sin. And that's why Paul says there at the start of verse 20, "For by works of the law, no human being will be justified in God's sight." Now, Paul knows that for many of his fellow Jews, this is what they were doing. Remember what he said back in chapter 2, verse 17. He said to his fellow Jews, "But if you call yourself a Jew and rely on the law," that's the problem, you see. They're relying on the law. They're thinking that if they keep the law, well, that will sort out the problem of their sin. If they keep the law of God well enough, they will be justified in God's sight. That is, in the divine courtroom, God, the judge, will declare them righteous. He'll accept them as such. And it's what a lot of people today think, isn't it, as well? That if there is a God, the way that you can be accepted by him is to live a good life by keeping his law. But that's not what the law does. Yes, the law shows us how to live God's way. But before we even get there, God's law shows you the problem of your sin, but it doesn't fix the problem of your sin. And for that, you need the gospel. You need Jesus. And we'll get to this next time, but in verse 21 and following, we come to one of the great turning points of this letter, where Paul shows us God's law cannot save you from your sin, but Jesus can. And he says, "But now the righteousness of God has been manifested apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ, for all who believe." And as we come to a close, let me ask you, is that where your hope is placed before God? Not in trying to cobble together your own self-made righteousness, by trying to obey God's law, but instead by resting on Jesus alone by faith, so that in him your sin is dealt with, atoned for, your guilt removed, and you're accepted as righteous before God in Jesus. Let's close in prayer. Our Father, we thank you for these words of the Apostle Paul. And your word tells us that every person is under sin, and that every part of every person is under sin. And so we confess that we are sinful people, and that sin has infected every aspect of our being. And we see sin's effect and its stain in our words and in our way of life and in our worldview. And even though we try and make excuses for our sin, when we look at your law, all of our excuses are silenced and we're held accountable, because through your law comes the knowledge of our sin. And we thank you that though the law cannot save us from our sin, Jesus can save sinners, and Jesus does save sinners. And we praise you for what he has done for us in his righteous life, in his atoning death, in his triumphant resurrection, so that in him and through faith in him, we know forgiveness from our sin, and we are declared righteous in your sight and reconciled to you both now and forever. So we pray that we would all put our faith in Jesus for that, because the gospel is your power for the salvation of all who believe. And in Jesus' name, we pray these things. Amen. Well, our final hymn this evening is number 480. And it's a hymn that refers to these words from Romans chapter 3. So it's appropriate we close by singing these words. Notice particularly the words of the second verse. Silent let Jew and Gentile stand, without one vaunting word, and humbled low confess their guilt before heaven's righteous Lord. All excuses silenced before God's law, the excuse of both Jew and Gentile, as God's law humbles us, shows us our sin, and points us to Christ for salvation. Let's stand and sing together hymn number 480. As we close, remain standing now and receive these words of benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. And the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.